Great. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Noyes Museum of Art at Stockton University. My name is Saskia Schmidt. I'm Director of Education here, and I'm pleased to be a part of this group of programs and events that tie in with the wonderful Pine Barrens exhibition that we have here at the Noyes. And, you know, these wonderful speakers that Tom Kinsella has organized for us, it's a great opportunity to, you know, learn more about the Pine Barrens. And I just wanted to let you know that we have more events coming up. This weekend we have something tying in with the MICA exhibition, but we also have more events that have to do with the Pine Barrens, including a Pine Barrens Jamboree. So don't miss out on picking up information about further events, and hope to see you again. So thank you, and look forward to a great talk.
Welcome again. I'm Tom Kinsella. I teach at Stockton College, and for the last few years I've been directing the South Jersey Culture and History Center out of Stockton. The role of the center is to try to engage Stockton students in their own backyard, to let them know there's a lot of interesting history and culture if they would only just look right here. And a second goal is to build bridges to some of the people that know about what's in our own backyard. And so we have Bud Wilson and Ted Gordon here with us tonight. I'm not going to give any elaborate introduction to these two. I think you probably know them well enough. And they'll tell you about their reasons for falling in love with the Pine Barrens as the night progresses. I will just speak a few words about the format tonight. I've asked Bud to start, and he's going to talk about what brought him to the Pines and why still after 50-odd years he's still interested in working in the Pines. About 10 minutes of Bud. Then trade off to Ted, and it's the same question, and he'll go for about 10 minutes. And then I'm trying to get these two into a conversation back and forth. Bud will have heard something that Ted says, or vice versa, and respond back and forth. Meanwhile, I will have Masters of American Studies students from Stockton circulating in the crowd, handing out cards and pens if you need them, for questions for Bud and Ted, which we'll collect up after about a half an hour, and feed these two gentlemen as many questions as we can, given the time that we have. I will also tell you that we have for sale up at the register copies of the brand new exhibition catalog to the exhibition that's up in the major gallery. This is at the tonight only low, low price of $14. And we've got the lovely republication of Ted Gordon's Herbert Payne, Last of the Old Time Charcoal Makers and His Coaling Process in the Pine Barrens in New Jersey, something that was originally published by Stockton in a series of essays, 1982, I think. And Ted has been talking with me for several years about republishing this thing, editing it to a certain extent to make it more up to date and to put color pictures in. It's a really lovely piece for $4 that's also available up there. With that, I will turn this over to Bud.
Can you hear me from here with the mic like this? Okay. Is it any better now back there? Okay, thank you. What I'm going to do now is actually a timeline of my area of the Pine Barrens. My parents both interested in the area. My dad was a state cop, second class in New Jersey in 1922. In 1923, he had the assignment to go to Chatsworth on horseback. He was a mounted trooper. And I lived my entire life just hearing about stories of that period in Chatsworth, but also on the White Horse Pike. In Chatsworth, he one time said that he hunted and gave game to the people in town who didn't have any meat on the table. I asked him whether it was in season or out, and he smiled. He didn't answer me. but I knew what the answer was. So I have that background, even to that period of time, him telling me stories I wasn't born to 34, but him telling me stories of that period. Now, and this is a picture of him in uniform, and I'm not passing anything around or anything like that, but it does exist. But the thing that is, when this started, and it was called The Lure of the Pines, something went off in my mind, because I had this photograph of me in the Pine Barrens when I was about 18 months old, in a potty chair, in a pike hole, where my parents were out to collect chain pickerel. And the minis died, and they used my diaper in a triangular piece as a lure to catch pike. That's it. That's all the photos. I remember going through the pines, the pygmy pines, in the dark, because what happened in 1937 was my parents were on Long Beach Island, and we were going home. My dad wanted to get some rest to pull off to the side and then go on. My mom pushed him over. I was in the back. Pushed him over, got into the driver's seat, and drove home. She never had a driver's license. Her whole life, she never had a driver's license. So Mom and Pop's idea was to have a house somewhere down in that area, and that was her dream, their dream, and so they started the antique business. Now, that's the end of that, and then you'll see how it comes in, because the books that they had for antiques became my books for material culture as an archaeologist. My first real trip of seeing the Pine Barrens and remembering them was a hurricane in 1938, where I was in a house in the hollow section of Long Beach Island, and the water came up and into the house by about 6 inches. But I remember after World War II, taking day trips, going out. My dad knew a lot of people in the Pine Barrens, and going down. And I remember seeing one time a fire at Lake Pine, and just a crown. And he just saw this crown and just a burning fire. My introduction to my dad and the book by Henry Beck of Jersey Genesis. And I did a book report on Jersey Genesis in ninth grade. If you ever read the front of the book, that is presented as a novel about, a historical novel, about the people of the Mullet River. I graduated from high school in 51. In 50, we went to Packin Pond, we're swimming in Packin Pond. My mother went to get the hot dogs and the hamburgers, and she'd forgotten them. My dad knew people that worked there. They went at the Busby store, got the hot dogs, and then came back, and we had lunch. In 1953, my parents got their dream house in Herman City, and I don't know how many people know Herman City. We simply always called it this old house. And that house was 10 rooms, built in 1827, or that period. In 1953, it had a pitcher pump and an outhouse. When I had to give up the house back to the state after my parents died, it still had a pitcher pump and an outhouse. I lived in that home for 14 years in that condition. Next year, it became part of the Wharton Tract. But when my parents got the place, it was still Gerard Trust who was administering it. Okay, now, 1957, the Batstow Citizens Committee, my dad was a member of it. These men, not men, but these people of the Batstow Citizens Committee were my TV of the day. That I just had a chance to talk to them all about the air. They also, at that time, there was the Pine Lands Preservation Alliance, and I had a chance to talk to these people, although I had no prior interest in the natural part of the environment, other than I was there and canoeing and in a Boy Scout and as a Scout leader. In 1958, and this is critical because I was sort of bouncing around and doing different things, but primarily at that time I was erecting chain link fence. Jim Starkey was employed to excavate the ore boat, and I took a week off from another job, went down there and helped with that. And then I decided I'm going to go back to school. I've been in the Army, I had a GI Bill available, and that's when I went back to school, and that's when I met this guy. Then I worked in archaeology for a few years with Starkey. There wasn't any work in any capital improvement in 63, but I did do some work as working with the naturalists and giving nature tours at Batstow at that period of time. In 64, I hired on as a carpenter at Batstow for the restoration crew, and worked first on the sawmill and then other buildings. And then in 65, it opened up for me to become the archaeologist at Batstow. And my major excavation of the glass house at Batstow in 65, 66, and 67. In 1967, John McPhee visited me on the site. Even though I was excavating the glass house, he wanted to know about iron. And I told him, this was Pittsburgh. In other words, Batstow was like Pittsburgh, and he understood, and a lot of people understood, that was really was Iron City. Even their beer is called Iron City. And so in 67, McPhee wrote the book, and he called me young archaeologist Bud Wilson, and I will be indebted to him forever for that, because yesterday I celebrated my 81st birthday. and anyone doing the book, I'm looking at the book, still reads young Bud Wilson. Thank you.
So, it's hard to top that, huh? My background is totally different from Bud's. My background takes me back to Germany, where I was born in 1937. I had 1 foot in the Middle Ages and 1 foot in the modern world. You cannot believe how drastically different Germany at that time was from the USA. The farming, I lived in Hockenheim in the southwestern Germany, what was then West Germany. In a town that was a farming community, I'd say about 12,000 people. And you would scarcely see a car anywhere. When I was a child, that I can remember from maybe fourth or fifth, age five. Farming community was what influenced me the most, because my family did some farming. We had a wheat field and a potato field. And we frequently worked for farmers, not for money, but simply for receiving part of the crop, getting extra potatoes, maybe some ham. And it was sort of a barter system. When I came to this country and talked to people about my early life, the old timers that I interviewed here and that influenced me a lot were amazed that I knew so many things about what was it like in their childhood, 40 years older than me, people 40 years older. But the existence that I experienced was of the old timers here. We butchered. We had rabbits that we raised, we had a pig that we raised, and we butchered that pig every year, and we had to feed these animals. I can remember my job from first grade on was to go out into the woods to get firewood, kindling wood, and load it into a family wagon, a wagon we built ourselves, with wheels about the size of a bicycle, four wheels, and you took that out in the woods, the community woods, and loaded it up with firewood, and brought that home. That was my routine, because in our house, we had one stove, no heating system at all. We had a hot plate stove, four hot plates, and you either burn coal or firewood, and mostly firewood. You had to feed the rabbits, so my job was to bring in feed for them with sickle. And but the interesting thing about the farming and the methods, mostly plow and oxen and horse, no tractors, nothing. The women did a lot of field work, hoeing and planting things that way. I remember planting potatoes. We had to cut the potato in half and put the eye, you know, had the ones with the eyes on so you could reproduce. And that was one of my jobs, to put these potatoes in a hole. And I did that in kindergarten already. Kids over there worked and grew up early. They call my generation the generation without youth. But I never looked at it that way. We were deprived in many ways. I lost my father in a war and never knew him. So I grew up with my grandfather and grandmother that raised me, while my mother went to work wherever she could. My grandmother and great aunt taught me to identify plants. And every event, I would bring home flowers. That was a common thing for me to do. And I think my wife, Pat, will still remember one of the first gifts I gave her was I picked a bunch of roadside flowers on her birthday when we first got married. And it was sort of, I had this love of flowers going back to that time. And I'm setting the stage for my Pine Barrens interest. And to go back to the farming, how many of you went to the Country Living Fair bat store this year? Mm-hmm. Not too many. They had this huge steam engine down there, the one with the heavy iron tires. Well, I was used to seeing those engines, those steam engines, all over Germany. We used them to power a thrashing machine, and the thrashing was done communally. My grandfather used a scythe to cut the wheat, and then the family helped pitch in to bundle up the chaff, stack it up, and then they used pitchfork, loaded the wagon, brought it to the communal thrashing machine, which was operated by steam power. So, and then you brought your grain home, and it was your turn to go up. You had a card, gave you a number. You went through the process, then the next guy would come up with his wagons and go through. So it was a very primitive way of doing things, but it had a tremendous impact on me. And all of the structures associated with this, the barns, you know, at age six, I learned how to thread tobacco. Believe it or not, we had eight tobacco factories in our hometown of 12,000 people. Everybody was into the tobacco in those days. And I would take the bandoliers, and they taught me to just shove the needle through the petiole of the tobacco leaf. And that would be hung up in tobacco barns that were all over town. Hmm. And I have a great vision of all of these old structures and buildings. And I know that set the stage for my interest here in the Pine Barrens about old structures and buildings, and caused me to photograph everything I saw. My mission when I came to this country, and fortunately my father was in the middle of my stepfather, my mother remarried in 1948, that's how we came over here. My stepfather was stationed at Fort Dix, and he was a company commander there for a short time, and he would take me all over the base, and I see these pine forests. It's like being back home. Seeing the pine, the species was different. It was pitch pine over here and Scots pine over there. But my experience in a forest left such a lasting impression on me that I felt like at home when I came to Burlington, New Jersey. We settled in Burlington, one of the oldest and most historic cities in the state. And I met Dr. Bisbee there, who got me interested in eighth grade. He lived around a block from me. So Henry Bisbee, author of, put out the, the Martha Furnish.
Signpost is his book.
On place names of Burlington County. So that background of seeing all these old things, and by the way, we still, when I left Germany in 1948, we still took our grain to the mill to have it ground into flour. I just imagine, I mean, no kid over here had that experience at that age. So I'm coming from a totally different background. I have all these things at my disposal. Dr. Bisbee tells me I would probably like reading the Beck books. And he told me to get them, and he gave me the titles. And I also met Watson Buck and Nathaniel Ewan, three local historians of utmost, Bud certainly knew them all too. Did you know
them? No, I never met Nat Ewan, but I knew the other two very well. I went to Nat Ewan's, where he was in the Masonic Lodge. My dad did.
And he
got a copy of the diary, my dad, Martha Furnish diary, and my dad copied that and then gave it back to him. But I was never up in the Masonic Lodge where he was living.
It's interesting. I have another typesetting from Darton Brooks Everett.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So we both got a hold of there were six typeset settings of the Martha Furnish diary. And Watson Buck had one, and I wound up with the other from Darton Brooks Everett. But anyhow, that's my background, and they give you some understanding. When I come over here, I see that forest, the Range Road was right next to Hanover Furnace. So I explored Hanover Furnace when on Sundays he was out on the range supervising, and I would go across the street and explore the furnace site. And Whitesburg was right next door. And I have a story to tell you about Whitesburg. We had a German family that had come over that we knew from Germany that lived right next to Whitesburg, and the old road into Whitesburg. And they had these blueberries on the table. Well, I'm from Germany, they got these blueberries the size of peas. And I'm seeing these blueberries the size of a cherry at Whitesburg on the table. And the woman told me they were from Whitesburg. I was 12 years old then. I said, I got to have these blueberries. I bugged my father. He finally went and drove me out to Whitesburg. And I asked Mr. Haynes, whom I got to know very well in later years. And I see Betsy nodding her head. You probably knew Haynes, the foreman out there. And he told me, son, come back when you're a little bit older. I remember that. But that began my interest in the Pine Barrens, these little snippets here and there. And we had another incident where an army officer that my dad had known from Germany gave us a Philadelphia address of his brother. And we should look up his brother when we come here. Wouldn't you know, on Sundays, every summer, routinely on Sundays, where did they go? New Jersey Pine Barrens. Philadelphia cab driver. New Jersey Pine Barrens. And where did they go? Absegami campground.
Lake Absegami.
Lake Absegami.
Yeah.
So I went every Sunday, Lake Absegami. And the other place was Brindletown. Do you know where Brindletown is? It's right on the border of Fort Dix and New Egypt. Well, Brindletown, part of it was on the base, and an officer's club was there. And I loved it because it had the dark tannin water, you know, the cedar water. And I would swim in there, and I loved to dive down under the water deep and go into those cold springs that came up. And all of these experiences were, as a young child, still as a teenager, or preteen actually, and that got me interested in the Pine Barrens. Thank you.
You want to start just bouncing stuff in a minute?
No.
Okay. Nat Ewan. And he was just so tremendous. He had 5-6 basically photographs, scrapbooks that he put together. They're in the Burlington County Library, and they're huge.
It's
incredible about the information that are in those scrapbooks. And the best for what I was doing were the photographs that he had taken of the houses, mostly Burlington County, but elsewhere, in a period of time of the 1930s. And a lot of those houses, of course, are no longer extant. I didn't mention it before, but when in seventh grade, I got up and talked what I wanted to be when I grew up. And the teacher, and I gave my talk, and the class was over, and she said, "It's pronounced architecture." The H, I was pronouncing architect. but I had an interest in architecture from that period of time. And I had at home, there were books all over. My dad would see a book and say, "How much do you want for your books?" for the person. And he would know in his mind that he could get $10 for a book. But he collected a lot of other books this way. And he collected and I used those books throughout school and throughout college. There were two full sets of encyclopedia. There were two different books on the signers of the Declaration of Independence. And I, unfamiliarly, but maybe wrongly, I just called them the Philadelphia 55. And they've always been those to me. I was interested in history at that time. In high school, I don't know if it was junior or senior year, I did a essay. You had to do a biography. I did an essay on not Thomas Jefferson, but Thomas Chippendale furniture. I had books on ceramics, on glass, on furniture, on pewter, on silver, on buttons. My dad collected guns. My mother collected buttons. We had in the house, we had Antiques magazine and also Hobbies. Antiques is really a glossy type magazine, usually of stuff that we never had at home because they were just often museum pieces. But my parents would get this material and buy and sell it to dealers only, mainly, except for a few that, you know, that people in the neighborhood that knew it. But that's how I began to know about art, antiques, material culture. And I still don't know anything about prices of antiques. But we had that material in the basement in a room that we called the log cabin. Now, the log cabin is actually cedar scantling on the sides with concrete between to make it look like a log cabin. At one end, there was a bar, with behind it, there was a place for booze. At one corner, there was an alcove for a piano. And during Prohibition, that was my parents' speakeasy. they congregated there with their friends. This isn't something that's open to the public, but this is where there was beer on tap back there and other things. A decanter with a music box on it that it played "Oh Susanna," and about drinking, a German song, correctly, about "Oh Susanna," and about drinking. So my dad had a little problem with booze in 1937.
Oh Susanna, yes, leaving off so sure. Oh Susanna, you get it.
My dad knew it in German, and so we. That's sort of gone by the 1937. My parents get interested in the antiques. The function of the room changes, but there's always two big bookcases on one side where there are books of every nature. I saw one of those books on political economy for $350. It's the only book that I had that was from the 18th century. Mm-hmm. But most of that stuff was oriented volume library, one that I used throughout school. One book just said it had every answer in there for any question you just wanted to know about us, you know, about America. and then books on, my dad read three books a week. And my dad and mom both had the Palmer methods, and they were just, the writing was beautiful. My dad at 19, he was in World War I. My dad, 19, comes back, and he was writing handwritten, handwritten insurance policies. And my mom had the beautiful script, but I inherited my mom's condition because she couldn't spell. And I can't spell either, really, but even at this time. But that's the household that my sister and I grew up in. My sister was 3 years younger than I am. It was in that room that she tried to teach me to dance, and I never learned to dance. I just never learned to dance at all. But that room was, it's also where his trunk was from when he was in the state police. We never touched that. It was locked. But when he died, I had a chance to go in it. He had a Bible, a New Testament that was given to him by American Bible Society with the triangle of the state police. I gave that to the state police museum. I had both of his badges from that period of time. 161, the triangular badge. One was worn up here in his Stetson, it's in this photograph, or in the campaign hat of later, that he used later when he was a motorcycle cop. In that was some insignia that the state police didn't have any anymore. There was also a whole collection of Bruno Hauptmann of that period of time and the trial of Bruno Hauptmann. My dad was not at the trial. He was not out of the state police by then, but he was he hunted up in that area. He knew the area, and he was part of the plainclothes policemen that were drawn in from all over the state. And that
Claude mentioned Watson Buck. Watson Buck lived in Lankokas. He was a fanatic collector of New Jersey history, literature, anything on New Jersey, the Civil War. His house, every single room in his house, floor to ceiling, was covered with bookcases. When he passed away, it was a five Saturday auction after Burlington County Historical Society had first shot. I know I went to them all, except the last one. My wife, Pat, had instructions on what to get at the last one. And they had a catalog out, told you just what to get. But I tell you, I have a fairly decent library. Paul Sharp has an excellent library that's very comprehensive. But I'm sorry, Paul. Watson Buck was that unique.
Was it 50,000? 50,000?
Oh, you know, you can't even begin to imagine what he had. And what he had in depth. I bought all my geological survey reports there and paid very little for them. But, you know, they're very expensive and difficult books to find. You know, talking about books, we knew so little about literature on the Pine Barrens until what date? Do any of you have an idea of when we started learning about what was out there? Anybody know an event? No, I'm talking about a publication that came out. Who's? At the same time, yeah. Jack McCormick at the Academy of Natural Sciences published a booklet. I think I wrote his name down. He did this for the National Park Service. It's called the Pine Barrens of New Jersey, A Study of Significance. And in that booklet was a bibliography of the largest extent known about the Pine Barrens at that time. That later became published as a museum report, a little booklet that's still available. that has a similar title, but 1967. That prompted me, and I'm sure many others, and Pat sent away for that booklet to the federal government, and she got it within a few days. They were free at the time. And that prompted me to begin a very serious library on the Pine Barrens. But, you know, very little was in books. The Pine Barrens were in public, remote publications. And one of the greatest areas where you would find information was in the geological survey reports. New Jersey had one of the earliest and most intensive geological surveys done in this state, dating back to 1930s already. The 1830s. And in it are the forestry reports and the industrial reports on the what we call lost and forgotten towns today. Old Union Clay Works, places like that, Brooksway, and these clay mining operations and the towns that were associated with them, and the benchmarkers and the description. You've all heard of Oriental, right? Keep trying to find history about Oriental. It's very difficult because it's nothing but a geological survey marker. So people, you know, call the place Oriental today, outside of Tabernacle there, in the Indian Mills. But that's what you discover in geological survey books. I bought as many as I could. I'm missing a few, but they're fantastic references. So we probably should shoot it out to some questions, right?
Ted's talking about books and the significance of books, and he's right, of course. The other way to get the information is to go to people that know it and have it in their heads. So I'm going to ask Paul Schopp to come up. He's got some questions. I'm going to ask Ashley and Bill if they wander through the crowd and pick up any more questions that there might be, and we'll ask a few and see what these guys can tell us.
Alrighty. What do you know about the Pine Barrens that you did not know 25 or 50 years ago? And what were you certain about 50 years ago that is now in doubt?
Okay, go ahead. But, okay. What is now in doubt? Well, it's sort of like...
Let me start.
50 years...
Let me start.
Okay, yeah.
I'll start. I think... 50 years ago, the New Jersey Pine Barrens were so ostracized that people went to it, passed through it, the plains on the way down to Manahawkin, Long Beach Island, and so forth, and they didn't dare go down the side roads, I guarantee you that. They were very suspicious of going on sand roads, because I know many of my friends would never turn off Route 72 to go down one of those sand roads. Those long-eared pineys are out there, you know? And that is no exaggeration. I taught German at Mount Holly when I did my student teaching at Mount Holly back in 1961, right? Yeah. And the kids that attended Mount Holly from Medford, the kids from Mount Holly did not associate with them. They're pineys. I'm not exaggerating. They're pineys. But very few people had the courage to go onto a sand road for fear of getting stuck or somebody would come upon them, one of those pineys out there. That's not an exaggeration. Go ahead.
My experience is a little different in that Ted and I both had Jeeps. I got mine the year I graduated in 61. And I had the experience of my dad already knowing a lot of the people that were there, including Tilton Eslow up in Wells Mills and the people in the costumes in Green Bank. and the people back in Bulltown. And Bulltown and Tylertown are two, and Herman City are towns that you don't know about. You might know about Greenbank and Lower Bank, and of course, Egg Harbor City. My mailing address is Egg Harbor City, and it just irks me that you have to use it because I live in Burlington County and I live in Greenbank. I'm not from Egg Harbor City. But my dad already knew a lot of those people, so my introduction to my dad to those people, including my own aunt, and actually including my wife's family, so that I have a different experience, and include, and but also at a period of time when year did you graduate from high school?
57.
So I'm back just Oh, 51 is when I graduated. 53 is when my parents got the house in Herman City. And so my experience is a little different, but very, very local. I mean, I never got about Route 72.
Yeah.
I never got down into southern parts, you know, so much into Mark's area, over there, Mark Dimitrov, who was here.
And by the way, Bud is a complete authority on Washington Township in that area. Mm-hmm. There's nobody that knows it better. And, you know, I think what I was trying to lead to is how little the area had been explored mm-hmm. early on.
Yeah.
Very few people had Jeeps. I didn't have my Jeep till 1970, but I had a Volkswagen bus that did pretty well. not a bus, the old bug, I mean.
By 68.
The iron bottom to it, you know. It did well in sand, but not too good in water.
I had a 68. I also had two Beetles before that. But my dad was also a friend of Henry Beck. Beck was a reporter for the Courier Post. My dad was, when they first met, a sergeant in the police force what became the Delaware River Port Authority. My dad went on a lieutenant, captain, and then they changed the title to chief. So I had, and I mentioned Jersey Genesis, but I had the introduction to most of the people, well, the ones still living, that are mentioned in that book, through my dad and through the Costa family next door. And the Costa family is just unique. And we both could talk some bit about a man by the name of Hollis Costa, who is basically a botanist of the periods of the, even into the 20s and 1920s, 1930s. A graduate, but I'm not certain of graduate. I know he made 4 years there. Rensselaer Polytechnical Institute. He worked actually in the Pine Barrens doing WPA, but collecting and identifying plants on the CCC camps. And he, I don't know, all, you've seen it, I have not seen it, all his material. That is in the academy.
Academy of Natural Sciences, herbarium specimens.
Let me move on to a different question. I'm reading a great group of questions here. We're not going to get to all of them, and I apologize for that. This is one that I was hoping you two would have talked about beforehand, but it's one of the questions someone has asked. Did you two meet at Rutgers?
Yes.
And how influential was your Rutgers time together on you?
Well, Bud was a tremendous influence on me. And what happened, we met at Rutgers, and he would come back every weekend on Mondays. We commuted. We didn't live down on campus. There were very few facilities there in Camden. Bud would come back and talk about his experiences doing archaeological work at Badstow. And
at the iron furnace at that time.
Yeah, the early work there. So I was very much attracted by these stories that he would tell every weekend he came in. And he was a reporter, a photographer too, for the...
Gleaner and Anemone. The yearbook and the newspaper.
Yeah, so he was very active that way, and everybody knew Bud on campus. And so we became friends, and he encouraged us to go down to Badstow. And my wife and I went down, what year was that, Pat? 59, right?
Yes.
Yeah, we went down there.
And the rest is history?
Yeah, the rest is history because ever since we've been in touch with one another, he gets a project. I remember he came to me about a project he had up in Leisure Town and the old factory that was up there in the Leisure Town area, historic factory site, and also Sui Place. He came to me about Sui Place, which is up in my territory. And the most recent thing I contacted him about was the Weeping Indian Reservation that was historic period Indian reservation outside of Vincentown. And he did a road return, which actually had the name of Weeping on a little stream there, and proved that we were not making up the story about a historic cemetery being there. And right now that's an issue in Southampton Township, an old historic Indian cemetery. So we've communicated over the years on various projects and interests we both have. Yeah, my explorations, to really answer to go back to answer more fully the first question that was asked by Paul, what is different, or what did you learn or didn't know then? Well, you really didn't know enough about the Pine Barrens other than what you read in the Beck books, for example, or later on in the books by Arthur Pierce, not to be confused with the later John Pierce, in different spelling, by the way. These books, these historians or folklorists, as Beck might be called, were nonetheless excellent documents. I found Beck to be far more useful than most people think. He was to every one of those sites that he describes. And it's an amazing task that he accomplished.
I think it's more marvelous that they're still in print when they were first printed in the 1930s, and in the case of Jersey Genesis in 1945.
The old pictures there are different, though, so it's worthwhile getting the old copies if you can. The photographs are not quite the same as the new ones. That makes them valuable. But I used Beck as a motivation to systematically, I went out to systematically explore the Pine Barrens. When I tell people that don't know me very well that I've been on just about every drivable trail from Monmouth County to northern Cape May County, they take that with a bit of skepticism. And I would too if I were in their shoes. But I assure you, if it was a drivable trail, I went on it with a passion. My friends used to think I was obsessed.
How many times did you get stuck?
Oh, I'd hate to admit, a Jeep is not a vehicle that you can take through with the, unless you have severe oversized tires, you shouldn't be driving through places. And today it gets more difficult now to negotiate the woods because of the all-terrain vehicles and the monster tire vehicles that have destroyed the roads. It is not just the roads, but the botanical sites. They've gotten, Al Horner can tell you some stories, and his documentation of that is superb. And, I think when I started out exploring the Forked River Mountains, it was almost impassable. My wife refused to go with me anymore because we got stuck so many times. But we always got help somehow from motorcyclists that were in the area that helped us out. Yeah. But I think what has changed is it's cyclical. Access today is difficult. If you wanted to just take a ride to certain areas, you can't anymore. Pre-1970, it was that way because the roads were not maintained, period. Forest Fire Service came in and maintained the roads, But every good they did has been undone now. And this, what it affects all of us, because the roads are closed, because some few have chosen to destroy the landscape. So it's not as easy to explore anymore as you could at one time. But I think around, starting in 1980s, Forest Fire Service really cleared up the roads between Whiting and Cedar Bridge in the vicinity of intersection of 72 and 539. That's quite a distance, all that back country. And then take Wells Mills Road all the way to Route 9. That's the greater Forked River Mountain area, which I love to explore, but it's very tough to get around in there anymore. So we got to do something about these people that are destroying our access. We should have access, and even Forest Fire Service can't get into some of those places. And that's why they close the roads, so it doesn't get any worse.
We have a very specific question for you. Could you talk about the Shane's Branch region? Do you know where that is?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's Pestletown.
Huh?
Pestletown.
Well, there's a Shane. There's a Shane down in what?
Okay. Lou, yeah. Which one are you interested in?
Well, this is a different section. That's the Shane Branch near Friendship Bogs. Flows in, I guess, that would be the Topahawken system. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, there were cranberry bogs in it at one time, if that's the area you mean. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's near Friendship Bogs. Yeah. It's a beautiful area. A sawmill operation was in there at one time. You still probably will find a basin if you know where to look. But cranberry operation was there. Evans and Wills had some of the bogs in there. They were one of the earliest cranberry growers in that part of the country. I was instrumental in getting the state to purchase the Friendship Bogs. And they picked up 2,000 some acres in there back in 1983, I think it was. Yeah. But it's nice country.
Let me ask both of you if you could talk about a favorite Pine Barrens place to spend a day.
Home. <Scott.
laughs> I don't get a chance to be home anymore. That's my problem.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't have too many favorite places. I like them all, but I think the Batstow River system or the Mullica system are two very beautiful areas. Some of those roads are difficult to negotiate. Some of them have been closed off because of the campsite, on the Mullica campsite. So probably the best way to do them is by canoe. And that's where some of the, you know, I don't usually push a certain book, but Parnes' book on canoeing the Pine Barrens, I think is one of the best books. It's very accurate. And the others, I really don't think have that much to offer. That would be one I would choose in exploring that area. Much of the, I don't know, if you're interested in flowers, it's best to explore probably by stream, because you can put in at a far remote from where the roads are bad and take out, you know, have another vehicle at the other end. But you need to get out of that canoe and need to get on savannah, so maybe it's good to go with somebody the first time that really knows the area. Because I used to teach classes on the Pine Barrens at various places, And I was talking to one of my former students who took a course with me, and he said that one of those, when I taught that course a few years ago at Woodford Cedar Island Wildlife Refuge, it was that what you need to have happen to you, you need somebody to show you what's there. Because if somebody says, where are the pine barrens, you know, and where do you go in the pine barrens? If somebody doesn't know anything about the pine barrens, it's difficult to start. So I say go over to Lebanon State Forest, Brendan Byrne State Forest, and start out. They have a trail system, and they can tell you where to get on the trail and where to get off. You might do some exploration on your own. If there's somebody that gives a course and you know the person is reputable, you might want to take the course just to get introduced to different sites. And I recommend that strongly. And I used to give tours a lot, and bus tours and jeep tours and every kind of tour imaginable. And people were so grateful for showing them where these things are. I remember reading an article in the newspaper by a pretty good reporter. He said a three-day hike, the entire Batona Trail was with one of the people that led me on this trip, and I didn't see anything. Millie Moore, who wrote a whole story, a whole history and trail guide to the Batona Trail, would turn over, would be shocked to hear that. But he probably never got off the trail, and it was nothing but a forced hike, you know, the 50-some miles from one end to the other, you know. But you need somebody to show you. I said I should have taken that reporter out and showed him so many different. Mm-hmm. You get off the beaten trail, you know. You go down into the savannas, and you'd be amazed what you see. But you have to get off the trail. There are things along there, but you need to know how to see. I think that's the key in anything, and you take the lead. And I think Beck did that for me. He was the lead. Mm-hmm. I'd go check. I saw that nice photo floating around, Paul, that you guys put in the in that little booklet about the grave at Union Clay Works out there. Mm-hmm. And you'd never know where to find it, you know, if somebody didn't tell you. I went around with Tiny Zimba, who was the fellow, by the way, that got the Betsy Ross Bridge, named Betsy Ross. Mm-hmm. He was a 300-pound man, crippled over, bent over, but he went cemetery hunting all over the Pine Barrens. He knew where every little grave was, and I palled up with him on several occasions. He knew all, where all the glassworks was. Mm-hmm. He told me about the coffin glassworks down where you live, mm-hmm. and Green Bank there. Green Bank,
and then the Herman City one, which is like
well,
West
the coffin, especially the houses on it today.
Yeah.
But you need help, you know. You need somebody to introduce you to the place, and I think you'll find it to be a remarkable place.
But what I remember when I said home, I've been fortunate enough to since 1961, and actually 53 part-time, except the 1955 when I was overseas in Okinawa, to live on the Moeika River. Three different places. The first place I mentioned where my parents had, I remember being there one time and hearing sitting up in bed and listening. I think somebody's building a deer stand. Moon's lit. It's out. It was my heart beating. I remember. I mean, hearing from there. I mean, you're seeing and hearing. I remember hearing barred owls, great horned owls, screech owls. Seeing all the little yard birds that you feed in the little feeders. I having fox quite come right into the yard.
Tell them which was your house on the parents' house. Tell them which house it was.
My parents' house was the Rebecca Crowley house, and there's now the headquarters of the Park Police in Herman City. Family-wise, it was Daniel Sawyer, He was a doctor out of Tuckerton, and there's actually the Soy, S-O-O-Y family, had that house. And then when I married Marilyn, my wife, in 1974, I actually moved to the Daniel Sawyer's wife's brother-in-law's house that was just a mile away. That house is Marilyn's house, and she inherited it from her grandmother when she died. But that family, and we could go on a long time about the Koster family, but Marilyn's mother died before I met the woman that became my wife. The house was with the garage, it was over 4,000 square feet, so it's a large house. Center hallway house, two rooms down either side, and then with an addition to the back. But her grandparents got the house actually from, well, the grandparents' name was Wabber, W-O-B-B-A-R. And the Wabber certainly, it came out of Germany. Otto Wabber came out of, was born in 1836. Now, you have my mother-in-law, who is Ruth Borden Wabber. Her father is Joseph Hazelton Wabber. Her mother is actually out of Canada, a Davidson, who came down and settled in the Hamilton area in the 1890s. Now, Hayes Wabber's mother, and that generation who goes back, she was a Birdsall, and the Birdsalls go back forever. They met the Indians in Weirtown.
So many Birdsalls.
And the Millers, my mother-in-law would have been in the DAR, except she died, and the papers came 2 weeks later. But her middle name was Borden, and Borden on her mother's side was the Prime Minister of Canada during World War I, a man who became Sir Robert Borden. So you have all this mixture of the German, the Canadians coming down, but incidentally also part of that group of 6,000 that went up from basically Massachusetts, Connecticut, and Rhode Island to replace where the French were kicked out in that period of time. In Nova Scotia. So you have all that mixture down there too. The Costas come in. The Costas have come down from
German,
and the Raps come, yes, but they come down from Brooklyn to the Pine Barrens. And Rapp had ships that moved charcoal. In fact, one of the ships was called the John H. Rapp, the name of the ship. And they held a coaling and lumber business on the Mohawk River. That's how they get there. The Koster family by name rather than the Rapp were the tavern keeper in Brooklyn, and they also had the tavern in Herman City, in that generation back. And of course it's Beck that interviewed the father and a couple of the sons to get all that information, for much of what Beck had written at that time. So you have this mixture. You have instead of people there forever. The people that come to the area because of the iron industry, because of the glass industry, and then move on to the iron and glass industry someplace else. But the people that stayed are basically the woods, the people that work the woods, the term that is used. In other words, they're the people that are logging, they're doing the charcoaling, they're picking pine cones, they're using sphagnum moss, they're doing all things of that to gather just to make a living. There's a was a display at Tuckerton Museum called, and I might have this back here, but a buck in the woods, a buck on the bay, and so they can make a dollar a bay, and all that, the whole work there, the whole system was seasonal, that you would do things. This is my grandfather Marilyn's grandfather and Leon Koster, of the same generation as, right. They had a boat and they went out and they caught rockfish. They caught enough rockfish, they bet $60 that they got for that. They had to split 30 and 30, but that's what the other people got for a month by just doing that.
And then they all, well, even working cranberries and having a small cranberry bog. And then I mentioned to the, where they had it in Tuckerton, that the iron and the grass industries were also seasonal, and they were actually three seasons. In other words, the iron industry, because the water wheel froze up, couldn't work in the winter. The glass industry, because it was so hot, didn't work in the summer. They could do other things in the woods, so they could have some employment, but they weren't paid to do the glass industry or the iron industry. But that's a connection with my wife's family. You know that they're there to the beginning, the Millers and the Burtzels, and then of course coming into the German part and the Davidson, but the Davidsons and the Denisons, my wife's great great grandfather was David Denison Davidson, and the Davidson family and the Denison family had both moved from Massachusetts up into the Connecticut, and then as the Davidsons came here when Hamilton was advertised at the health area, the Pine Belt in the
I think we have taken our allotted time, a little bit more, in fact. I'm thinking about Bud's last statements about the mixture of the folks in the Pine. Thank you for coming tonight and listening to Bud and Ted. We've still got a few more minutes to wander about the noise before they kick us out, I believe. But thank you very much.